In data out earlier today, the Philippine inflation rate hit a record low in September to 0.4% year on year. It's the slowest in 20 years. I'm now joined with Gareth Leather, emerging markets economist at Capital Economics, to look at this and more coming out of the Philippines. Gareth, thanks for joining me, first of all. Now, of course, the Philippine inflation rate reached a two-decade low in data out this morning. Was this an expected result, and what will it mean in terms of rate cuts?
The sharp fall in inflation in the Philippines that we saw in September is pretty much expected, and it's actually been mirrored what's going on across the rest of the region. A number of analysts have said this is a kind of cause for concern, that it signifies that the region's economy is slowing and that they're set for a kind of prolonged period of deflation. I think what it does actually mean, though, is that the sharp fall in oil prices that we've seen over the past year have had a big impact on inflation. That's showing up clearly in the consumer price index data. The biggest reason for the fall is the sharp fall in energy prices, which is leading to a fall in transport costs and so on. And what we expect to happen is that by the end of the year, this impact will have kind of gone through, and so inflation will rebound quite sharply towards the end of the year. In terms of the implications for monetary policy, the central bank could cut interest rates if it wanted to. A number of central banks in the region have, but I think it's very much aware that this period of very low inflation that we're seeing at the moment is temporary. And because of that, I don't think it will cut interest rates in response to just a kind of short-term dip in inflation.
Earlier this week, we also saw the World Bank lower its 2015 Philippine growth forecast from 6.5% to 5.8%. What are the main drivers for this reduction, and what does it indicate for the country's economy?
Yeah, sure. It basically reflects the weak performance of the economy in the first half of the year. And that was mostly due to a slump in exports, which again has been mirrored across the rest of the region. It's nothing really specific to the Philippines. The domestic side of the economy, so investment, manufacturing sector, consumer spending, has actually been doing okay. And provided exports do start to recover over the coming quarters, which we anticipate they will based on improving prospects for global demand, then growth should rebound later in the year and also in 2016. So I think the big picture is that although growth in the Philippines has been a bit weak in the first half of the year, it should start to recover and remain one of the fastest growing economies in the region.
Yesterday, US and 11 other countries announced the landmark Pacific Trade Pact, which would affect 40% of the world's economy. The Philippines have expressed an interest in joining the TPP, but what do they stand to miss out if they don't join?
I guess, first of all, it's important to put this in a sense of perspective that the TPP is potentially a big deal for potentially the countries that are going to miss out as well, but it's not going to provide a short-term boost to the economy by any means. That first of all, the TPP has to be passed by the US Congress. It's by no means clear that it will do. And even then, some of the provisions are going to take quite a while to actually be implemented as well. So it won't provide a short-term boost to the economy. But over the longer term, it could potentially be not so much a game changer, but quite a big boost, arguably the biggest boost to global trade that we've seen since the Uruguay trade round 20 years ago. So if the Philippines isn't able to enjoy, it's going to miss out potentially on quite a lot. Just access to the world's biggest market at the moment, which is the US, and Japan, which is still the world's third largest economy. And I guess another area of interest is that a lot of the provisions in the TPP, they go beyond just normal tariff reductions. So they include things on enforcement of intellectual property rights and government procurement and stuff. So it would be a kind of reform mechanism, or an enforcement mechanism for further reforms in the Philippines as well, which would also be welcome.
That was Gareth Leather from Capital Economics with me there. Now make sure you're tuning back to Dukascopy TV later. Monica Gibson will be looking closer at the current US economic landscape. For now though, it's goodbye.